Good morning. I'm going to make, first of all, I'm very honored to be here, and I'm so glad you ordered this weather for me. I must tell you honestly that when I finally realized that this was a master class, not a class for master students and PhD students, I kind of freaked out and I thought, oh my gosh, because the only master classes I have ever been attending were at a school of music where like Victoria de Los Angeles would come and mentor singers and be her glorious star self. I'm not going to even try that. But I'm going to be informal and somewhat personal. In French and Norwegian, there's a word causerie, which is more informal than a lecture. And it will probably be more a causerie than a formal lecture. And you, if something I say is unclear and you need clarification, chances are pretty good that somebody else thinks it's unclear too. So you can stop me and ask, what exactly do you mean? I was thinking when I listened to you about sociology and social work, we could probably do a whole different session on that. And my last appointment was in a joint department, and there was a two-culture problem in Norway between ways of thinking in the two disciplines. So I'll come back and we can talk about that. The title I sent off was Moving Beyond Age-Segregated Research, Why Linking Studies of Children, Life Course, and Aging is Important. I'm not using PowerPoint because I want to stare you into your eyes and you meet your eyes, but you will get some slides on the website later. When I had a chance to think about it, sort of on second and third thought, I realized that I should have added two more things. Sex, gender, and family. So really, what we're talking about, if we were to do a Venn diagram, it would be five circles, and then trying to explore the intersection between these five circles. Because we all know that you can't really talk about age starting before birth, even, without talking about sex and gender. There's a classical piece that I highly recommend by Ralph Linton from 1942 called Age and Sex, where he talks about them as twin statuses. They always go together across societies. So when you sort a group, like you have been to a party and people say, well, who was there? You'll go by age and sex, won't you? And age and sex are both ascribed statuses, to speak sociologies, and constructed, right? And one thing that fascinates me is that in some languages, you can make the distinction, such as in English, between sex and gender. In Norwegian, it's one word. In German, too. What is it in Gaelic? Can you distinguish between sex and gender in Gaelic? Yes? Yes. Well, it's interesting. Yeah, and I will probably touch on a few more examples where some of my languages just can't express it. A concept that's very easy to express in another language. There is, I think, one reason why Linton hasn't gotten enough attention is that he published the article during World War II, and it sort of got lost. Because I think it really is a classic. He was the first one who said, if you talk about age, you also talk about sex, gender. Basta. And there is a literature that came in the 1970s about how aging is very different for men and women, that physical signs of aging have different meanings. And two women wrote about the double standard of aging. The first one was a sociologist. The second one was Susan Sontag, and everybody thinks that Susan Sontag thought it up, but she didn't. Was a sociologist. But in the original article, the author says that physical signs of aging, such as gray hair and wrinkles, make a man look distinguished and a woman over the hill. I would also want to add dimensions of time, and I hope we can get back to that, especially the intersection between biographical time, which is age, and historical time. That, and I hope we can really kind of dig into those. I think you already, hopefully, have gotten a picture of complexity. And I want things to look complex because they are. And the complexity of some of the issues that we are trying to tackle today makes dialogue absolutely essential between demography, epidemiology, social policy, gender studies, family studies, life course studies, social psychology, developmental psychology, gerontology, just to mention a few. Now, in my discussion today, I'm going to use my status as an old woman, and I realized when I'm an old woman, I'm going to wear purple, remember? Yeah, I did, unconsciously. And I noticed that the sign on the door says, the old staff. So I guess I'm the old staff. But one really nice thing about growing older is that you get a new freedom in all sorts of ways. People can't get you. You don't lose your job. And I still remember I gave a keynote, I think it was in the 80s, in Leeds, in the UK, where Maggie Kuhn was one of the other speakers. And she was by then a very old lady. But she taught the formally dressed, mostly male professors in gray suits and ties to growl like a gray panther. And I'll never forget Maggie standing up in front and saying, get up and growl. And you had these men go, no louder. I thought, only an old woman could do that. A friend, colleague in Austria, Leopold Rosenmeier, who's almost 100, I hope he's still alive, wrote 600 pages on unfortunately, I think only in German, called Die späte Freiheit. 600 pages on the late freedom. That's a lot of freedom. It also means that I can allow myself to be personal. But I'm also quite convinced that if we really want insight in our scientific endeavors, we cannot exclude our personal experiences. Even Albert Einstein said any scientific question worth its salt starts with a personal problem. And I also start, I think, from the axiom that comes from Socrates that the examined life is more worth living. But I also am convinced that the personal is by necessity interpersonal. And here comes some of my theoretical orientation in. I just published a paper with Rick Sederstein, who's a former student, saying in a special issue of the Gerontologist on aging, it's personal, and our essay says aging, it's interpersonal. My reason for thinking that way, and Rick, being my student, thinks the same way, is partly because of my academic history, and I'll just talk about that very briefly. But first of all, the older I get, the more I realize that being a war child is a big part of my life history and my biography. I was born in an occupied Norway. My father was a teacher and a principal, born 1908. The oldest of nine, all of the children survived to adulthood. He grew up on a farm. My mother, who was born in 1915, but in a coastal community where there is open sea to Scotland, and lots of seafaring people, was the youngest of nine. But in that family, four did not survive to the age of five. She was the youngest born to her mother when the mother was 50. So she was not only an unplanned, but I think also an unwanted child. If you were a mother and had lost four children, would you want to try again? I really doubt it. And so I have these childhood memories where history comes in very loudly. The first one, and I think I was two, it was when I was still taking naps in the daytime. And my little bed was next to my father's bed. And his wallet was lying on the bed, the little stand. I was already then curious. And my name means fighting woman, so I don't like to give up. And I got hold of his wallet, and it turned out that it had a razor blade in it. And I cut myself, and there was blood all over my bed. And of course, I screamed. When I was a child, I kept asking my father, why was there a razor in your wallet? Because this was such a vivid memory. And he didn't want to answer. But when he was an old man, he did answer, and it had to do with his activity in resistance. That if he was caught, he wanted to have an out. Now there's war for you. In 1945, after the war ended that spring, we moved into a schoolhouse that had been occupied by German troops, and it had lots of graffiti. And some of those images are still very vivid and scary. And there were rats everywhere. I remember that too. But the war child in me makes it very difficult to throw anything out, especially food, because we had rationing on all food and clothing items way into the 1950s. And you just did not throw out food. And I can't do it. I make the most ridiculous stews and soups. History also comes through my mother, who, from the family where four children died. And as long as she lived, and she lived way into her 80s, my mother, when we made plans, would always say, if we live. And she was more clearly than my father part of a demographic regime that we now have put behind us. We've come to take a long life for granted. And as several authors have pointed out, starting with Becker, there is, as part of that, a denial of death. And in the US, there is a bestseller that was just translated into Norwegian. It's written by an Indian American MD, and it's called Being Mortal. And he too addresses this issue of, in our gains of having fought main causes of death, especially child mortality, we have also gotten to a point where we tend to deny death. And I see that in my grandchildren very clearly. That's something that you just don't talk about. I remember another image from my childhood was my brother, who's born in 1946, which is the biggest birth cohort ever in Norwegian history. Lots of children conceived in glee over peace. When he was about two, he had double-sided pneumonia. My mother completely freaked out. She was beyond herself, because to her that meant death. And then the country doctor came with his leather bag and said, Mrs. Hagestad, relax, take it easy. I have a new miracle medicine. It's called penicillin. Your son is going to live. And he did, and became an MD. And I remember lying under my duvet, practicing, saying, penicillin. But here we have a couple of watersheds, and that's a concept that's really worth taking with us. For when history almost creates a before and after, and you get a new breed of cat, and we need to go to the post-war years before we have children who their entire lives have had access to antibiotics and vaccines against common childhood diseases. Part of my story, besides being a war child, of course, when I go to Germany and meet my peers, most of them never knew their fathers. The father disappeared somewhere on the Eastern Front. That's worse than my razor blade and short food shortage. But part of my story is also being bicontinental. That I was educated on two continents, in Europe and in the US. And so I'm both an insider and an outsider in two places and in two languages. If you haven't read it, you really should have read Alfred Schuss's essay on the stranger. Simmel also has a wonderful essay on the stranger. Both of them make the point that being a stranger, not totally an insider, but not totally an outsider either, has its advantages and its costs. Because you can get away with things that a true insider cannot, and you see things that a true insider is blind to. But I also think that I have been a stranger in another sense, and that's too many times I've been a vanguard. I'm born early enough that too many times, from my perspective in my adult life, I've been the first, the only, the only woman in the room, the only mother on the faculty. And that, too, gives pause for thought because you have trouble building what Tony Antonucci and Kahn call a convoy and what Daniel Berthaud calls co-biographers. And now that I'm old, I notice that really very clearly, partly that I am from a cohort where people died. I lost a cousin to polio, a neighbor girl to pneumonia. And by the time you reach 70, you have lost some of your consociates. In our day and age, mostly to cancer, especially among women. My graduate work was done at the University of Minnesota, and my favorite teacher there was Herbert Feigl, who was part of the so-called Vienna Circle in philosophy of science. He wrote a classic book on mind-body dualism, the mental and the physical. Very thoughtful man. Came to class one day and said, "Last night, the advice of my son, I got stoned to see if it gave me new insight in mind body." And we said, "Well, did it?" He said, "No." My first job was at the University of Chicago. And those of you who are sociologists will know that there is a Chicago School of Sociology. And symbolic interactionism started there. So there comes this. Yourself is a social product. And you can't construct reality without the help of others. When I started in my job, Victor Turner was on the faculty in anthropology. And he really has influenced me a great deal, and many of my friends. His concept of liminality, do you know that one? It's based on van Gennep's classic book, Rite de Passage, from 1908, that when you move from one phase of life to another, you are in flux, you're liminal. And liminality is both dangerous and holds promise for new things. And he combined it with communitas. So there comes the U of C component. Now, right now, my style of making this presentation is marked by the fact that I'm liminal right now. I just lost my only sister. And for the first time, going back to Herbert Feigl's main intellectual dilemma, I have found that my mind has completely taken over my body in some ways. My brain didn't function for several weeks at all because of grief. And I'm hoping that the liminality will take me in new directions, because it very often does. But in the process of being in the liminal state, I have often wished that we had kept a tradition that was very strong in Norway, and maybe it still exists in your country, which is when you're in mourning, you would wear a black ribbon, which was a way to announce to people that be a bit careful, be gentle, because I'm right now vulnerable. I think we've lost something by giving that up, and it is probably part of that process of denial of death. But we all live in liminal time. We live in revolutionary times, historically speaking. We live in the midst of a demographic revolution. And we are trying to still understand what the digital revolution will mean for social life. Almost all of human history, half the population has been children. Around half. And maybe 1-2% over 60. There's one country left, according to last UN figures, where you have close to half of the population children, and that's Uganda. But most of the countries where you have more children than adults are currently in Africa. Because they are still in the first phase of the demographic revolution and demographic transition, many of them, where we have the means to reduce to very little childhood mortality, and it becomes a given that you will have a long life. And I've often thought, remember that children should be seen and not heard? You probably have an expression for it too. I know it in several languages. Well, when half the population was children, there was some sense to that, because it would be very noisy. if they really were to be heard. What I find that I'm a stranger or in between on the border in terms of seeing death as omnipresent or something that you always have to take into account, I can live with. I also have to find ways of living with the IT revolution. And maybe I have more trouble with that one. I use computers and electronic communication a lot, much more than many women my age, especially women, because so many of them have not been in jobs where you had to. Right? That's the vanguard part. But there's something very disturbing, and I have just recently had the ability to put it into words. When I was a student, a book that really changed me and affected the way I looked at the world was Martin Buber's Ich und Du. You, thou and I think is the, I and thou, I think is the English translation. That the fundamental unit of human communication is the dyad, the twosome. Do my children and grandchildren have lots of twosomes? No. They're on Facebook. They have 200 friends that they share everything with and look for likes. And I find that so difficult that I refuse to go on Facebook. But it probably deserves the label of revolution. And I think we lose something fundamental if we leave behind so much of the dyadic. I, with my personal history, talk to you with your personal history. And the unit is unique because we each bring our unique experiences and thoughts to that encounter. That's very different from Facebook. Now, this is a long way to get around to talking about age, but I'm getting there. Because what I'm trying to do is to give you sort of some conceptual analytical things that you might, tools that you might use and ponder. Now, what's age? Well, you have biological age, right? And a changing organism that matures and ages. These biological processes are given cultural meanings, and anthropology has an enormous literature on age grading and rites of passage where physical, biological, so then we have social age, right? Now, there's also the concept of life course, which has inspired lots of my work, which takes us as the starting point, the social age. Now here is one where Norwegian cannot express a distinction that English can. German can't either. And that's lifespan and life course. Can you do that in Gaelic? Okay. In German, both of them are Lebenslauf. In Norwegian too, which is makes our language poorer because we all would agree that, yeah, there is the lifespan of the developing organism, and then there is the meaning that the changes take for men and women, male and female organisms, right? The life course has some key concepts, transition and trajectory. So the trajectory is the pathway across transitions where you go into a new stage or phase, with or without rite of passage, right? But life course also says your biographical time, your age, is shaped by historical time. And now we can't escape a third meaning of age, which is, of course, chronological age. We live in a society where that is, we have lots of rights and duties based on chronological age, right? Whether or not it makes sense, but it's rational. So historically, when we had gotten to a place where we had controlled mortality, made it more predictable, we had the development of modern nation states, the notion of citizenship that entailed rights and duties, then chronological age became extremely central. And the author who has talked about that the best, I think, is Martin Cooley.
And of course, he writes the original pieces are in German, and Germans make nouns out of verbs in these absurd words. So chronologization is his term, chronologisierung, that we have more and more emphasized chronological age. For instance, in the school systems, where you bunch together kids who can be developmentally extremely different in levels of maturity and cognitive development, right? But it's so practical and so democratic to bunch them based on chronological age. So one implication of the life course perspective is that no matter what phase of life you happen to be the most interested in, you cannot escape history. And now we get to the fact that age also is a stand-in for cohort. Age, how many years you've lived, places you in the flow of history. And when I teach life course, my really main purpose is to make them addicted, my students addicted, so that after they've taken the class, they automatically, when they hear how old a person is, they say, oh, so he was born in, and he was 10 in, and became 20 in. What kind of society was that? And there are so many professions where that kind of thinking is essential. And we've touched on some already. You have to know if the person in front of you, if you're a nurse or a medical doctor, even a dentist, has that person had access to antibiotics all her his life or not? In my mother's cohort, many, and in some in my cohort, including me, have heart trouble because we had long-lasting bacterial infections such as streptococcus, that went untreated, and they left our heart damaged. The same goes for food, same goes for possible trauma. And so all of us really have to have the help of historians to make us conscious of the flow of history and our placement in historical times. And I find, for instance, that institutions for the old have so little awareness of historical starts and where the old people were when they started their own family. What was society like at that time? Was there enough food? Was it a safe, secure time? Or was it a turbulent time with uncertainty and insecurity? It's so important.
Now, where do the bookends come in here? You were probably waiting for that. Well, they come in that's where the action is on so many of these change variables, because demographic change has to do basically with the balance between young and old. The middle segments are much more stable historically. So if you look at the balance of old people, 65 and over, and children, you know, it's pretty incredible. In Japan, which is the world's oldest country, you already have twice as many 65 and older as you have 15 and younger. By 2040, it's estimated that there will be three times as many. Norway currently has about the same, and that goes for, I couldn't find Northern Ireland. I found some figures and I left them at home. But Ireland and the UK, you have fairly similar proportions of old and young, but Ireland and the UK have the same Ireland has the same proportion of old people as the UK has children. And that's because fertility is higher in Ireland. Now, does Northern Ireland, I would think in terms of fertility that you might be more like UK. No? No? Aha. That's interesting. Good. Now, what's age segregation? Peter Uhlenberg and I wrote two papers together in 2005 and 2006 on age segregation. And really, they are still the only sort of broad overviews of should we worry about age segregation and what is age segregation? And we say, well, it can be institutional, it can be spatial in terms of where people live, spend their time, and it can be cultural. Now, do we in our research activities practice age segregation? Yeah, I think to some extent we do. And it, because programs are very often defined by chronological age or life stage. And you're a good example of it, right? But we need each other, because children will become old people. And I get irritated by this in Norway a lot, because family in Norway, partly because of social policy,
is young children and mom and dad. That's family. Yes. It's totally disregarded that those parents are also children and often grandchildren. Right? Four generations are very common, five generations are not totally uncommon. And you chop up not only faces of life that are closely connected, but you chop up relationships that are completely interrelated. And here the life course perspective has some concepts that are very useful, and that's linked lives or interdependent lives. And if you take an interdependent life perspective, then this Norwegian definition of family is crazy, but it is institutional age segregation in that policies are made, school policies is for the young, care policies are for the old. You have separate ministries and separate municipal offices for the young and for the old. And there are only a few countries, Austria is one, where they belong to the same ministry. But more and more of us keep arguing that they have so much in common and they need each other. If children do not have contact with old people, they will become historyless. And that's very dangerous. If old people do not have contact with young people, they become ignorant. Because in a society that's very rapidly changing, this is probably the quote I use the most of any quote from Margaret Mead, in a rapidly changing society, the old become immigrants in time. They have to learn new language, new ways of relating. And of course, in many countries, the new communication technology, cell phones, computers, is number one on the list of what the old need children for. But there is also anthropological work, and my study of grandparents showed the same, that it's often easier to teach and learn. Does Gaelic have two words for that?
I only know how to say hello, cheerio, and thank you.
I kind of assumed that a few of you would know Gaelic.
If you knew our history, you'd know why.
I know that, but still,
you need to go to the West Coast.
In Norwegian, there's only one word for teach and learn. And that makes good sense. Because, as my father said, you always learn as long as you have pupils, students. And in the process of teaching, you learn. We do our society, our developing and aging individuals, a great disservice if we block contact between the bookend generations, because they need each other very much. And when you skip a generation, some of the problems of communicating across disappear, because grandparents, for instance, don't have the kind of investment in their grandchildren that the parents do. You have to be perfect, you know, so that I look good as a parent. Grandparents couldn't care less in a way. They accept much more. And from my work on grandparenthood, when we ask parents in the your father taught your son anything, and we got all that, you know, skiing, fishing, wood carving. And then we said, has your son taught your father anything? Nah. And so what emerged was this secret life between grandparents and grandchildren that the parents were unaware of because of modern communication technology. And when, and one boy that I interviewed myself said, yeah, I taught my grandfather how to put snow tires on the car. He was 10. And I thought, why didn't he ask the father in the middle? And then it made perfect sense to me that why he didn't. Because the 10-year-old said, sure. The son would have said, Dad, come on, you can't tell me that you're 75 and never learned how to change tires. That's ridiculous. Right? So there are all kinds of possibilities and potentials in that relationship. I'm running out of time, and I'm not.
Now, there is another thing that we need to keep in mind, and I am, I'm really struck by how often this is not taken into consideration. When you have an aging population with new survival patterns, because we have beat all the infectious diseases, mostly. I'm going to be totally neutral here. The natural superiority of women it shows up more clearly. And it makes sense, doesn't it, that the organism that's giving birth to the next generation would be hardier when the cause of death switches from infection to wear and tear. Because giving birth is a very risky business in terms of infections. So lots of women, when we died of infectious disease, died in childbirth. So part of the demographic transition is a feminization of the population. And so across aging societies, when you go beyond age 80, you have about twice as many women as men. And you see that on a family level as well. So if you look at the centrality of the maternal grandmother, which does emerge time and time again, it's important to keep in mind that she's the youngest. The less central position of the paternal grandfather is that he's the oldest, and men have higher mortality, so that there are fewer paternal grandfathers altogether. If you look at people who are in their 40s and 50s who still have living parents, 90% of those parents are mom. So the mother-daughter tie is qualitatively different for sort of more demographic, epidemiological reasons, not necessarily because of role similarity. And I get upset at how little recognition there is of just the basic demographics of age and sex in later life in aging society. And of course, the fact that we women are stupid enough to marry men who are younger than us aggravates differences in life situations between men and women. Because many more old women live alone,
most men have partners. Because of survival differences and marriage markets or partner markets. There's also differences in morbidity that, which I sort of touched on, and that's that women have more chronic diseases, such as osteoporosis, hypertension, diabetes too. So they are sick for maybe 20 years with chronic illness, but it doesn't kill them. Men have more acute illness. They're drop deaders, as a colleague of mine said, who started as an MD. And there's an English saying on this, right? Women are sicker, men die quicker. Yeah. Again, when you look at the social worlds of children in different countries, this becomes very important. And I have now searched high and low for people who are looking at Russian children, especially Russian boys. Because Russia has the biggest difference in life expectancy between men and women in the aging part of the world. It's currently between 11 and 12 years. But the women are asked to retire early. But what I am very curious about and concerned about is, where are Russian boys going to learn about what it means to be an old man? There aren't any. And men are the people that start and carry on wars. Who's going to tell the boys that war is not a good solution? Nobody that I can find, and I know lots of demographers. There's a Russian couple at the University of Chicago, but they only do the mortality stuff. Why do men live shorter than women? They don't do anything on the consequences, and I have yet to find anybody who does. Isn't that incredible? And I have sometimes wonder if Russian children, when they talk together, they whisper and say, you know what? When you become old, you become a woman. So that's one of my hang-ups. It's really a pet peeve.
What I want to do is just to kind of basically talk about how sociology thinks about children and childhood. And I'm starting from looking at Jens Kortrup from Norway, from Barry Thorne. And sorry, he's what?
He's Danish, but he worked.
Danish, sorry, do you know something? This is terrible. It's like getting English and Irish mixed up, and anybody comes from Scandinavian countries, which is appalling. I get it mixed up all the time. Jens Kortrup from Denmark, who works in Norway, or used to work in Norway. Mm-hmm. I know he's retired. Jens Kortrup, Barry Thorne and Bill Cossero in the United States and Prout and James in the UK kind of started a whole way of thinking about children and childhood probably around the 1970s onwards, and kind of basically criticised sociology for a neglect of children and childhood. Children and childhood were considered as members of families, were considered as school pupils in the educational system. So if you got a book, Introduction to Sociology, you had a chapter on the family and children in that chapter. You had a chapter in education, children in that chapter. But they weren't given any kind of conceptual autonomy. And all of these theorists talked about how sociology was written by adults, mainly for an adult audience, and mainly reflecting how adults viewed childhood. And this led to a whole then plethora of studies, all focusing on trying to redress that balance and trying to look at how the social world is lived and experienced through the eyes of children and young people. But one could say that there was almost a neglect of the wider worlds in which children lived. So the adults that occupied those worlds of children and their childhoods was kind of neglected, with a couple of people talking about how generation is an incredibly useful concept for trying to think about the relationships between adults and children. And basically, I'm going to really whiz through this. A whole host of people kind of arguing that one way of looking at the relationship between adults and children in this shared world is through exploring it through this concept of generation. And what I've been trying to do in my work is to kind of look at structure and agency and how that plays out across adulthood and childhood. And I've come up with this concept which I'm calling gender agency. And this gender aspect of the concept involves acknowledging this ongoing relevance of generation for understanding the location of childhood and adulthood and the possible implications of this for both parties. And I'm looking at this gender agency as a mutually reinforcing and interdependent relationship between generation and agency. Children practice agency, but they practice agency within the positioning of childhood relative to adulthood. And I have thought about this through two further concepts, which I'm calling intergener agency. I'm using this term to look at the relationship between adults and children. I'm looking at these relationships as partly hierarchical, because they're hierarchical in law, in culture, in education systems, in family systems. And that this kind of intergeneration, say, illuminates the macro framework within children, within which children practice their agency. But nonetheless, the complexity of these relationships are not just related by age, but they're related by class, by gender, and by ethnicity. And that these relationships are dynamic and these relationships are multidimensional across all of these structural variables. I'm also arguing that boundaries exist between adulthood and childhood, but like all boundaries, these aren't fixed positions. They are porous, they're fluid, they're constantly shifting, and they're constantly changing. And I'm trying to look at this here in my own empirical work. I'm arguing that adulthood and childhood are practiced relationally, that each term can only be considered with the other. The relationships are, for the most part, asymmetrical, but that would be far too simplistic, narrow way of looking at these relationships. These relationships are interdependent, and these relationships are reciprocal. And within this broad asymmetrical relationship, children accept, they challenge, and they modify this relationship in a myriad of different ways. I'm also looking at Musa Mitha's concept of differently equal, to sort of argue that relationships between adults and children are differently equal, that adults, these relationships generate consistently shifting fields of negotiation and renegotiation, whereby the norms and expectations are actively challenged and modified. Children accept strategies, at times complying and at times resisting adult expectations. I also am using this term intragenerationcy, and Gunhild had touched on this as well, to highlight the heterogeneity of children's everyday lives within the structural location of childhood. That children don't experience these boundaries in uniform ways, with age being the core variable. Rather, other structural boundaries intersect with age, such as class, gender, ethnicity. And these variables interact socially, practically, and culturally with generation. So again, children don't simply internalize the adult world, but they actively select, they dilute, they contest, and they challenge aspects of this adult world. They constitute their own reality. They reproduce, they undermine, and they reconfigure stereotypical understandings of childhood. Trying to see how I get this to move on. This is great.
Was that the last
slide? No.
No. I also have an additional concept, which is intra-generagency. And intra-generagency, is that it?
No, I don't know what's happened.
Okay, it's my last slide that I really wanted to kind of... So what I have is intergenerational, to look at the relationships between adults and children, and then intragenerational, to look at the relationships within childhood among different children. And Gunhild, your work has really made me kind of think much more theoretically about relationships within adults. Within the structural positioning of adulthood. And I want to thank you because I found your articles really, really interesting. And I know you used it as an oxymoron, the relationship between an adult child and older people, and to kind of think about how dependency, independency and interdependency are played out within childhood and within adulthood and between both of the two. And these concepts are ones that I'm kind of using to try to think about how dependency, independency and interdependency are played out within the realm of childhood, within the realm of adulthood, and then between both. And then, oh dear Lord, could you get me up my tree by any of this? And then what I've tried to do is to, sorry about this. So what I'm saying is I'm using this here to try to think about relationships between adults and children, but then relationships within childhood and relationships within adulthood based on age, gender, ethnicity and class. And what I've tried to do is visualise this by what I'm calling a generation tree, like a tree of life, a kind of a tree that's kind of showing how adults and children occupy the same social world, they come from the same social world, but then what I have is that structures in that world, legal structures, cultural structures, position them as almost two separate units. You have adults and you have children, but that this is nonsensical because the leaves in this tree are intertwined, and in each of these branches I have the terms age, gender, ethnicity and class, to show how each of these variables are structurally interrelated throughout the life course of children and adulthood and the relationships between the two. And apologies, that's really, really, really quick and probably all over the place, but that's my way of thinking it. And Gunhild has kind of encouraged me to kind of think about intra-generationcy much more informed through thinking of adults, older adults and middle-aged adults, and to try to think of it. I think that this is going to add to what I'm kind of doing by kind of trying to think out this notion of intra-generagency and to try to think about these relationships. I've been exploring them through childhood, but less through adulthood, and I think the incorporation of older people, of which I'm one, although I'm on the cusp of it, since your starting age was 65, which I haven't just reached yet. So I whispered to Colin, woo, I'm not old yet. So that's me finished.
Okay, lovely.
Also, Paula had asked me to give a little bit of information on why we're having the discussion groups. Yeah, so maybe I'll just say that as well. Basically, as you can tell, what we wanted Gunhild to come is, and she's just fantastic and really makes you think and drew together so many different themes and things that have been bothering me in my research and things that I would love us to tackle in these discussion groups. The big one, the big huge one for me is this feminization of aging, the fact that we don't consider gender enough. And when you start delving into the feminist literature, what you find is actually quite a big generation gap within the feminist literature. There is a certain baby boomer feminist generation, and then there are newer, younger feminists, and the people who originally were the leaders are then, so we see ageism within the feminist movement. There's also this thing of looking at history, I'm very encouraged by too. So I'm going to be very brief, but I am going to mention one other project that we're working on at the moment, and it's particularly because from a different angle much more slowly and in a much less eloquent way. I've been looking at things the way you're looking at them to some degree. And one of the things that's really started to bother me is how ahistorical so much of our social science research is.
Amen.
Yeah, and it really bothers you when you look at older people, because I would look at it from the perspective of somebody who studies ageism. And I think, well, actually, if you just look at a person who is 60 plus or 65, and you say, right, that's an old person, what you're forgetting is where are they on the life course? In fact, what they are experiencing is something called longevity. It's not just aging. It's actually that they are living a long life and therefore have a particular perspective on life that is really valuable. So I'm trying to work with historians now, and Paula and I have a really nice little pilot project that we got money from the Wellcome Trust, where we're actually using arts as well to ask people to gather six objects that they think are important and interesting, say something about their lives. And the idea comes from a memoir written by Penelope Lively. So it links into that older feminist that are writing now about the aging experience. And two things that Gunhild said actually really resonated with what we have found with that project. The one is about the men and women. I don't agree that women are superior.
I don't either, but I wanted to tease you.
But that could be my cultural background, growing up in patriarchal Ireland as opposed to Norway. I don't think they're superior, but I do think that this idea of aging being interpersonal is women get more. Women understand more, possibly from a young age. Because one really interesting thing is that we have had no problem recruiting men to the project about stuff. Show me your stuff. And the men want to take part. And what's really interesting as well is, you mentioned a number of times, what are we losing? What are we losing when children grow up without a grandparent to tell them what history means, or to show them history? And we have come across a couple of examples of that from the men in our study. It's only a tiny little pilot. But two of them are very mechanically minded, and they're really upset and worried about the fact that there's a whole mechanics of the 20th century that is being lost. One of them was a radio officer, so he used Morse code, and nobody understands what that means anymore. But yet, in fact, when we use information technology, it's informed by that thinking. So we lose the sense that, and it's not a simplistic older people are valuable. It's more a case of we lose a sense of where we all are in time, and we all become immigrants in time if we don't adapt to this new demographic where we actually think about where our positioning is, which Gunhild said is much, much better. So in the discussion groups, I'm the one who's really keen about the discussion groups, because I think it's really important for all of us, particularly any people who are working on PhDs that are related, to have an opportunity to ask some questions. You'll be put with people who are staff members as well, and to try and articulate some of the issues so that you will all go back to your work and maybe put in some of those little gems of ideas that Gunhild has presented to us. But also what I'd really like is to develop relations between the people who study children in our new giant seesaw school, somebody called it seesaw, people who study children, who are mainly from education, and people who study ageing, and to see could we start to do some of the radical things that Gunhild said. You know, could we actually say, well, could we create some kind of space within schools or something where older people could actually be in those schools and we could have some kind of intergenerational contact? So only, no pressure, like.
Okay, so I'm a researcher within the Center for Shared Education, and you know, you talked about no pressure, let's just change the world. I want to talk about a theory that I think can change the world, and that's the idea of contact theory, and that's the theory that underlies shared education. So I want to talk just a smidge about shared education and what it is, and then kind of pull into contact theory and how I think it kind of relates to what we've talked about today. So most of you I know are aware that in any divided society, but particularly in Northern Ireland, division is often manifest within the school system. Now, this might be working knowledge for most people, but within Northern Ireland, we can think about three main sectors of education. So you have the controlled sector, maintained sector, and the integrated sector. So the controlled sector primarily recruits pupils that are primarily from the Protestant community. The maintain sector primarily recruits pupils that are from the Catholic community, and that integrated sector tries to capture pupils from both communities and neither community. So we get these three different sectors, but what we know from the research and from the statistics is that 92% of our kids go to these separate schools. So schools that are primarily populated by members of their own community background. Now, because kids spend so much time within the school system, that means their opportunities for contact with children from the other community is limited. And it might be even more limited because of the communities that, or the neighborhoods that the people live in. So we get this limited opportunity for kids to kind of interact with one another. So what shared education is, it's an initiative that tries to create partnerships between these three different school sectors so that the schools can work together to create shared classes where the pupils might move from one school to another school to sit in a classroom together with one another. Now, it's a little different than integrated education because where you have shared education, you're giving parents the choice. Do they want to send their pupils, send their kids to the school that they feel might represent their ethos or it might represent their community? But either way, you're giving them that choice. So the sharing of education doesn't necessarily go against that kind of desire for your community to be represented in your school. So I'm going to kind of push that to the side just so I can talk about the theory that underlies shared education, which I think is relevant today, and that's contact theory. So contact theory is a relatively simple idea that was proposed by Gordon Allport in the 1950s, and it's a theory that says that if you can bring together members of different groups, so people who are acting as representatives of their social groups, if you bring them together under certain conditions, that should reduce prejudice between those opposing groups. So it's not just throwing two people together into one room and saying, become friends. There has to be structure to that kind of contact initiative. And that is, people have to feel like they're coming together with equal status. They need to feel like they're pursuing or creating shared goals, so they're working together in cooperation. And they also have to feel as if there's institutional support or authority sanction, so there's a norm that this is okay. We should all be interacting. We're equal status. This is all right that we're doing this. So this idea here behind contact, bringing people together, that's well and simple enough, but the question is, why does that work to bring people together in this way? And some of the processes that people have suggested is that when you bring people together in these kinds of situations, it offers the opportunity for friendship to develop, to really get to know one another, so that getting to understand people from that other community or that other social group. But what we also know is that affect is incredibly important. So when people enter these interactions for the first time, maybe they've never met somebody of a different social group, there's a high level of anxiety that can happen, and that can really spoil those contact initiatives. So what we know is that by creating these positive contact situations, anxiety is reduced. People want to interact more in the future. And also, empathy is increased. You begin to feel for that other person. So the contact hypothesis really took off. While it was created in the 1950s, it really took off, all the research behind it, about, I'd say, 17, 18 years ago. So a huge meta-analysis was conducted on all of the big research that was kind of coming out, and it came across positive. So it's saying that, yes, contact does reduce prejudice, and it does it across a number of different domains with different social groups, different kinds of tests that were done in a different environments. But what's really interesting, especially since we were just saying that ageism is such a huge ism that it really receives relatively little attention, the work behind contact theory is primarily focused on intercultural contact. But there is a small body of work that's starting to look at contact between members of differing age groups. So this is called intergenerational contact. And what this research suggests is that children that experience regular, sustained contact with older adults show more positive attitudes towards those older adults, right in line with the theory of what we would expect. But what we also know is it reduces negative stereotyping. It also reduces anxiety about growing older. And it also works in reverse. So it's not just the young people who experience a reduction in prejudice or ageism to the older person. The older person as well is showing a reduction in ageism, kind of in that reverse direction. What's difficult about this sometimes, though, if we think back to the situations that have to be, those conditions that have to be there for contact to occur, when you think about a younger child and an older adult, they're not often meeting as members with equal status. Hierarchy is often kind of embedded within those situations. So what the work is kind of showing is that when we look at contact with grandparents, that's not as strong with a reduction in ageism as, say, an adult having a work colleague who is older. In that situation, we're talking about peers meeting each other, people who are in equal status. So we gotta give more time to think about that quality of interaction and not just the quantity, and how hierarchy might become embedded within these situations. Now, unfortunately, I think I've listed every single piece of research that's been done there on intergenerational contact, so it's still quite new, but it does look like those results are really promising. Now, the other piece that I wanted to kind of mention is a brand new piece of research, and that's called transgenerational contact. And this is a bit different than what I've been talking about previously. So when we talk about contact, we're usually talking about two people physically meeting one another. But that's not the only type of contact that can be positive for reducing negative attitudes, increasing positive ones. What we know is that indirect contact, so if I know somebody who is a close friend of mine, I know that they're interacting with somebody from another social group. That's enough to have that kind of positive impact extended out to me. That can also be the case if I'm watching TV and seeing two people interact. Those kind of perceptions that it's okay for people to interact with one another, that I know that my friend is doing it as well, that's enough for it to kind of fall back towards me. So that's called extended contact. So you're not directly experiencing it, it's an indirect kind of way. Most of the time, or all of the research up until this point, has looked at this idea of extended contact as just being between friends. So if I have a friend who's interacting, or if I have a partner who's interacting, what we want to do at the Center for Shared Education is kind of flip this and look at this between children and their parents. So within shared education, you've got a whole group of young people who've been born post-agreement. So they don't really understand the same or have the same kind of historical baggage that their parents might have. So you've got these children coming together, they're interacting with one another, they're creating these great friendships that are developing. We want to know is how is this impacting their parents then? How is that contact that the kids are receiving kind of transmitting back to what the parents think about community relations, or even whether they would have contact with somebody from the other community? Now we're doing a bit of research on this right now, specifically focusing on primary school kids, not necessarily post-primary school, because of the high level of, or high opportunity that might exist for parents to meet one another. So when you think about primary school kids, they're making friends with one another, and they love each other, they're great, oh, it's their birthday, they're gonna go to birthday parties together. That's an interaction where parents would end up meeting one another. So we wanna look at the kind of within this sphere, not to say that we don't think it would exist for post-primary school, but there's a different relationship between parent and child there. And I wanna kind of say that as we've been talking today, I've been really, really aware that we should extend this to not just parents, but to grandparents as well. So if anything today, I'm definitely switching our studies and writing an ethics form today to include that within it. I think this idea of transgenerational contact is particularly important here in such a divided society because the historical context is so different for each age group. And that's something I think that we kind of need to take into context as we kind of move forward with this. So I think that's my time. That's me.